Loving me, I loving you. Mothers and fathers, husbands and wives, sisters and brothers, friends for life, won't live in the past. All I wanna do now is making it last. Mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, friends for
time for another conversation. Welcome to Make It Last podcast. I'm your host, Noreen Daly, and we're talking about grief and loss this time around. And we're talking to Edie Nathan. She's the author of It's Grief, The Dance of Self-Discovery Through Trauma and Loss. Welcome, Edie.
Oh, it's great to be here. Thank you.
Now, we're going to be talking about how can one's mental health be nurtured during the grieving process. So we're gonna take it in two pieces and then we're gonna put it together. So for you, when you think mental health, what does that mean?
Mental health means something different to everyone. What I mean is that there are thoughts, feelings, emotions that get in the way of feeling centered, balanced. And those emotions or thoughts can interrupt your well-being, your sense of self, your ability to interact with others in potent and intimate ways, and that you find you are more transactional rather than interactional. And we find that emotions can certainly affect the ability to relate and to relate in the work environment, in social environment,
mm-hmm.
relate spiritually, and relate to yourself and within your body.
Okay. Before we go to the other side of it, tell me, when you say the whole idea of feeling centered or balanced, is this something mm-hmm. that is highly, highly individualized, or is this something that It's something that can be done, you know, society wide.
Oh, I want to say that it's yes to both.
Okay.
You know, we can, I think that society, our world can feel off center or off balance.
Okay.
And I believe that energy and collective energy has the potential to actually change that.
Mm-hmm.
And if I may just give you a very quick example of mm-hmm. this, they've done a couple of studies where they had two sets of 10 people who both had issues around their hearts. And one group was prayed for. They did not know they were being prayed for.
Mm.
Another group was not being prayed for. They did not know that they were even, you know, they had to give some permission of something, but they didn't exactly know what it was. The group who was prayed for far exceeded healing than the group that was not.
Hmm. Interesting.
And that is group energy.
Yeah, interesting. So we're going to add the other piece now, which is the whole idea of grieving. What is the grieving process?
So the grieving process is different for everyone. Grief is like your fingerprint. No one will grieve the exact same way that you grieve.
That's true.
And so the grieving process is a process where there is something that you are missing and yearning for. There is something that feels like it is lost within you. It is like you have lost a limb and it won't be retrieved, and you don't know how you're going to manage without it.
Mm-hmm.
But you do.
I know you've been enjoying the conversation, but we're going to take a little break and get a word from our sponsor.
Are you looking for one-of-a-kind products customized to suit your needs? Then shop at Trending Things, the place where customization is always an option. From personalized gifts to apparel, accessories, drinkware, and home decor, you name it, we make it. Get your favorite designs on any item for party favors, weddings, graduations, or any special occasion, all at affordable prices. What are you waiting for? Visit our website at trendingtings.com to order your trendy item today. Trending Things, bringing creativity to the things you love.
I remember about 11 years ago now, that would have been 2010, when my father died, and a friend of mine said to me, don't let anybody dictate to you how you grieve. And I realized that was the best advice that I could have received at the time. And I've been passing it on ever since, because I think there are a lot of people, and they look at you, and because you're not grieving as they would expect, they start to wonder.
That's right.
They start to wonder if something is wrong with you. So it's a it's a nice segue now into how then can one nurture their mental health while they're going through grieving.
One of the big pieces here is to be able to label, name, and I'm not talking about labeling or labels. I'm talking about to be able to name what is going on within you. So because everybody grieves differently, and I talk about this a lot in my book, there are 11 phases of grief. And within those 11 phases, they don't follow any one path. Grief is non-linear. There's no path. That's why I don't call them stages. I call them the phases, because you move in and out of them, and sometimes they're layered, and it's not a beginning, a middle, and an end to each thing. They move, right? So you can feel anxiety and anger and guilt and shame all at the same time, and it's all part of the grief reaction. It's also a mental health piece. So this is helpful for anyone who's listening to be able to sit with themselves and take a moment to listen. What am I experiencing? What am I feeling? Am I angry? Am I isolated? Am I afraid? Am I scared? Do I feel like I'm in a cave and no one sees me? Or do I feel like all I'm doing is ranting and raving and people must think I'm a lunatic, and then there's shame? And remember, the difference between shame and guilt is shame is about who you are, and guilt is about what you do.
Repeat that. Shame is?
Shame is about who you are. Like when someone feels shame, it's because it feels as if who they are is being degraded. Whereas guilt, it's like, oh, I didn't do something. Shame is about how you are seen, or how you have been felt to be seen.
That's interesting. That's interesting. What then would you say are some practical ways that people can actually nurture their mental health? Because I believe one of the positives, I believe, out of this pandemic is that people are actually paying more attention to issues like these, the whole idea of mental health, because they're recognizing that no more than ever, we need to be paying attention to this. So what are some of so that's one of the positives out of this pandemic. Go ahead.
Yes. So to nurture your mental health is to pay attention to it, and to understand that mental health is not just mental health, that mental health has like four connections. You've got the emotions, you've got the physical, you've got the spiritual, and then you've got the psyche, which is the soul. And that mental health relies on those four aspects. So one of the ways to nurture your mental health is to look at those four quadrants, if you will. What is going on with me spiritually? Have I lost something spiritually? Have I lost faith? Or do I want to change the way that I pray or who I pray to. So that affects mental health. You know, when someone stops believing and they get shunned by their community for no longer believing in what the community believes in, that shunning can affect mental health and can also feel like grief and loss and isolation. So that's why I'm saying this is it's a breaking down the quadrants, and the way to nurture is to say, what do I need spiritually? What do I need emotionally? What do I need physically? And what does my soul need? And to really burrow down into those four quadrants, separating them into four distinct baskets, and just kind of allowing yourself to be with them, not ignore them. Because to your point, we have had to pay attention in ways that we've never had to pay attention within these lifetimes.
I know you've been enjoying the conversation, but we're going to take a little break and get a word from our sponsor.
So the whole idea of a branding strategy sounded so exotic and so fancy to me. But after having several conversations with Neon, I now have a clearer understanding. I am sure of what my identity is, what it is that I want people to see Noreen Daly as. Thanks, Neon. Thanks, Splint. Visit them at wearesplint.com. What has worked for you or for people who are close to you? What have they done when they're grieving to nurture their mental health? Or what have you done?
So one of the things that I do, and I'm pretty consistent with it, is I know that if I don't move my body, that my grief loves to come and invade me. And they know that the movement of the body can be better than any medication out there to help with depression, anxiety, and the movement of the body, even if it's 10 minutes a day and taking in good, deep breaths, can actually affect mental health and can change my mood very, very quickly. The other thing is that right now we've been in severe social isolation.
Yes.
And that isolation, even if you are an introvert, and I talk about introversion and extroversion in my book, and ambiversion, which is a little bit of both. Ambiverts have a little bit of both. So it is good to understand, are you an introvert, an extrovert, or an ambivert? The thing is that even introverts need some kind of communication or, one-on-one meetings. So know yourself. And part of the book is really talking about how to get to know you as you are facing loss and grief and trauma, because you are the person who holds the answers. So what's worked for me is the exercise, is actually eating well, is actually not isolating. I know that I've had friends who call and then I don't call them back because I feel like, oh, I'm sad and I don't want them to pity me. And so instead of pitying me, I will isolate. And what I've had to learn over the years is, even if I'm feeling badly, if they are a true friend, then they will be able to hold me in my loss as well as hold me in my joy.
It's interesting you should say that, because one of the things that I've found myself doing recently is that actually going for long walks in the morning. And I find that when I do, for an hour or more, and I find that when I do that, I come back feeling, basically reinvigorated and ready to start my day, I do agree. When you do get active, and try to do that on a consistent basis, it does help. Because I find sometimes that I also get some of my best ideas when I'm walking.
Yes. And, not everybody, and this is really important, not everybody can meditate in stillness.
True.
Especially if you're grieving and there's some trauma along with the grieving, because most often trauma has occurred when someone has felt safe and then the trauma happens. So stillness does not feel safe.
Yes, 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 yes. I'm almost sensing like we need to have a part two of this conversation as we're wrapping up, though, Edie, because I believe that there's just so much more about this that we could talk about, and I will have to have you come back and tell us about those phases of grief that you have in your book that's called It's Grief, the Dance of Self-Discovery Through Trauma and Loss. So I'm definitely going to have to set
that
up.
I would love to do that, Noreen. I would absolutely adore to continue to have this conversation.
Yes, we're going to. But as we're wrapping up, though, any final thoughts that you'd like to share on the whole idea of nurturing one's mental health while they're grieving?
So one of the big pieces here is that we have stories, and, you know, they will be different culturally, that are stories that tap into the superhero. For me, I happen to love The Wizard of Oz, but it can be any of the superhero stories. Sometimes seeing the power of the story can really help healing. Mm-hmm. So go to the stories and find stories that can offer a different perspective and a perspective of, I've got this, and I've got the power within me to handle what I need to handle.
Thanks. Thanks so much, Edie. I will definitely be in touch, and I'm sure my listeners will want to hear about those different phases of grief. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
This was another conversation, a conversation that I'm hoping that has helped all of us to just have another perspective of grief and the whole idea of mental health and how we really need to be nurturing it when we're grieving. Because a lot of us, sometimes we bottle up too much inside when we really just need to just let it out. This was Making It Last podcast. I'm your host, Noreen Daly. Until next time.
Are you struggling to become an effective communicator? Let Noreen Daly, the communications specialist, get you there. Services include communications consultancy, one-on-one coaching, public speaking and debate training, leadership and team building sessions, plus much more. Visit NoreenDaly.com for more info. Noreen Daly, redefining the way you communicate.
Mothers and fathers, husbands and wives,